Reactions occur when atoms change what they are attached to, or the way in which they're held together. The way they are attached or held together is with electrons. In organic chemistry, we are interested not only in what products we get from given reactants, but in how the electrons move to get there, which is called the mechanism of the reaction. This helps us understand similarities in reactions and even helps us predict new reactions. Chemists use arrows to represent the movement of electrons and have established conventions as to how they are to be drawn and interpreted. Those conventions will be used throughout this course, both for writing mechanisms of reactions and for predicting resonance structures. The goal of this video is to create an understanding of and some comfort with electron movement arrow conventions, so that you will be able to write arrows well before that gets all tangled up learning the organic chemistry. The reaction mechanism I'm writing here is three steps. I was initially given only the reactants and had to write the arrows, the electron movement arrows, and the products of each step. This process involves not only using electron arrows, but predicting what is likely to happen at each step based on knowledge of typical organic reactions. Our examples in this video and exercises will not use organic reaction knowledge. In this video, we will do problems that deal with only one step of a mechanism so that we can focus on the process, not the chemistry. We'll either be given the reactants and the arrows and be asked to write the products of that step, or we'll be given the reactants and the products of that step and be asked to write the arrows. As you go through the organic chemistry course, each chapter on different classes of compounds will talk about the likely behaviors of that new functional group. For example, alkyl halides have a tendency to lose the halogen as halide ion. Pay attention to that part of the chapter. It's important for writing mechanisms. In this video, we'll be trying to visualize what the electron arrows mean. We'll be looking at the conventions used in writing and interpreting those arrows, and we'll be learning how to avoid common mistakes that brand you as a beginning O-Chem student. Let's first look at a representation of electron pair movement showing stylized electron clouds. The single covalent bond between the C and the Br is drawn as a cloud of electron density representing two electrons shared between the two atoms. The process we will look at is the heterolytic bond breaking of the C-Br bond, in which both the electrons from the bond will be moved onto the Br. Heterolytic means that both electrons in the bond are moved. Watch carefully. Next is a representation of the same process using Lewis structures. A line represents two valence electrons in these pictures, either a bond or a non-bonding electron pair. The C-Br bond breaking to give both electrons to bromine looks like this. Briefly comparing the two representations we have seen, gives you some idea of what we are doing here when we're showing bond breaking. The next visualization method is the usual electron arrow movement method, the one we'll be using a lot this year. It is really a stylized, quick way of writing what we have just shown with Lewis structures. We will compare the arrow notation, that's the new one, with a Lewis structure method. The arrow is on the left, the Lewis structure is on the right. The accepted convention for writing electron movement arrows is that they must start at the electrons to be moved and point to their final location. This is very important. Also, we are moving pairs of electrons when we draw a double-headed arrow. A single-headed arrow is used for when only one electron moves, as in free radical reactions. Next, we have a different example. See if you can follow the arrows and predict the structure at the end of the step shown. Watch the arrow notation method on the left. Have it figured out? Ready? As you can see from the movie on the right, the pi bond of the double bond was used up here to make a bond to H, and then the Br left as Br minus. When the pi bond moved away from one of the carbons, that C felt the loss of an electron and became plus one in formal charge. This example has more than one pair moving. They are likely to be moving at least partially at the same time, not sequentially. But unfortunately, I'm not good at doing different things with each hand at once, so this representation is a little flawed. When you're looking at electron movement arrows that other people have drawn, they should always point from the electron pair to its new location. Here are some varieties. We've seen the arrow pointing from a bond to an atom in our alkyl halide example. This means the electron pair moves onto that atom. It could also mean the same thing. Pointing to an atom could also mean, as shown in the second example, that the electron pair bonds that atom to one of the atoms originally connected by the electron pair. You can see that here in the example with the alkene and the HBr. If the electron pair starts out between two atoms, like in this structure, the pi bond, sometimes you will need to know some chemistry to identify the likely bond that is being made. I have shown here two perfectly logical structures from the mechanism arrow shown. When you get to this type of reaction, in a chapter coming up soon, you will find out why the structure on the left is the one that dominates. This is the same reaction I just showed you, but the arrow here kind of points to the space between the two atoms instead of pointing to the atom that is going to be attached. That style is sometimes seen too. In this example, an arrow moves to a bond. That means that the electron pair makes another bond there. In this case, you're making a double bond where there was once only a single bond. So, to where are you allowed to move electrons? Have you noticed what happens in the mechanisms we've done? Note that in every example, the electrons that were moved stayed attached to one of the original atoms when they were moving. They cannot fly away. Watch carefully. Also, remember that when you are moving electrons around, it is acceptable to end up with atoms short of an octet, in that case you'll get a plus probably as your formal charge, but you can't have more than an octet. You may have another electron pair moving away from the atom to fit a new pair in, as was shown in these examples. You have undoubtedly noticed that the formal charges changed on some of the atoms in our mechanisms. Here's an easy way to keep track. Remember that when you determine formal charge for an atom, you count one electron for each shared electron pair as belonging to that atom. If a pair of electrons moves away from an atom, that atom owns one less electron, like the C on the top example and the O on the bottom example. It therefore gets a formal charge plus one higher than it was before. The atom that gets the shared electron pair gets a formal charge with one more minus because it essentially owns one more electron. You just know you will have mechanism problems on exams, probably every exam. How do you keep from making silly mistakes? Remind yourself of these three things. 1. Start the arrow at the electron pair being moved. Arrows show the movement of electrons, not atoms. The highlighted arrow shows a very typical wrong answer, and there is no electron pair on an H atom. You do not want to use an arrow to show the H moving over to the O. The arrows are used for electron movement only. Secondly, you might have noticed that when more than one double-headed arrow is drawn on a structure, the arrows are all pointing in the same direction, like a waterfall coming down steps or bubbles bubbling up. A diagram with double-headed arrows pointing toward each other or away from each other is a sign that you need to rethink that answer. The arrows proceed in domino fashion, like the waterfall or the bubbles, because they represent one pair of electrons being pushed out or leaving because another is coming in. Another hint to quickly check for silly mistakes is that the total charge, counting all your structures, will be the same before and after the arrows. If you start with a plus and end up with a minus, go back to the drawing board. Look at these examples again. The total charge is minus 1 on the left because you have the minus 1 ion and a neutral, and minus 1 on the right, you have a different minus 1 ion and two neutral compounds. Here's a summary of what we've covered. This summary is available as a download. Hopefully you are now on your way to good mechanism writing.